We will call the November 29th study session to order. We have one agenda item by request of council to be held tonight. And I think we're all really looking forward to a downtown parking conversation. I think it's lots of preparation has gone into this meeting. We'd like to especially thank our economic development team. We know you guys have worked hard to get everything ready for tonight. So thank you for your efforts. I expect a good conversation and some outcomes that we can all look forward to. So with that, we'll turn it over to Amanda Elliott.
Mayor, council members, my name is Amanda Elliott, and I am the Heritage District Liaison. I'm so glad to be here to talk about parking policy. So tonight, we're just asking for direction and discussion on our recommendations for a comprehensive parking policy in the Heritage District, realizing that no decisions are to be made at a study session, but direction to be given. To help us facilitate that, we have eye clickers in front of each of you. So what you will do is press the power button. This power button does shut off after a certain time, so I'll just remind you guys to turn it back on when we ask a question. You press A for yes, B for no, which will be listed on the slide, and we will then have live results. So just to try it out so we can see that everybody's is working, I'm going to press start polling, and if you guys could click A or B. We need six. There we go. Okay, so we should be able to see our results. For the purpose of transparency, we have all of the serial numbers written down for your eye clickers so that we can understand who voted for what throughout the process. So we appreciate all of you who participated in the survey regarding parking policy. That was really helpful in providing direction for tonight's presentation. Through that survey, we realized that there were three main areas of concern for council. So maximizing the number of spaces available, mitigating Gilbert's financial responsibility, and providing convenience and access to visitors. So we really took that into consideration and then also utilized a number of various areas that helped us build our perspective and the recommendations that we're giving tonight. So first, we really looked at the fact that the Heritage District is designated as a redevelopment area. So we really wanted to keep that in mind. We've done public outreach meetings starting in February of 2015 regarding the Heritage District parking being a key component to those outreach. We had two studies done by Kimley Horn. One was a parking study, one was a traffic and circulation study. We then took the results and findings of those studies to the Chamber and to the merchants for their recommendations. That happened in September of 2015. We did a community outreach survey. We had 4,000 responses in October 2015. And then approximately a year later, we reached out to Walker, who is a national parking consultant, and asked them for some financing options for our garage, particularly looking at lease rates. We also initiated our garage number 2 master planning, and through that process there is a component of that contract that stipulates that Walker will help us understand our parking policy and the financial impacts of a policy. We reached out to you within the last couple weeks for a parking survey, and of course there's ongoing research and city comparisons that we've done. So this just really gives you the breadth and depth of how we created our recommendations and ideas behind this policy. So just to tell you kind of what we found through this process and all of this insight we've gathered, policy is not a one-time event. It's an ongoing process, meaning that as the district continues to evolve, our parking policy will also need to evolve. We also know that this is really a comprehensive and holistic policy, not just a financing tool. So we will be coming back to council with various areas, which you'll hear about tonight, for additional direction. We know that policy is really about managing our parking inventory. We had honestly hoped that we'd find a silver bullet to give you guys tonight and say that here's the package and it's going to completely fit Gilbert's needs 100%. However, we realize that each city has its individualistic needs, and there's not one tool, one parking tool that really fits all of our needs. We have not found a single model that has 100% cost recovery while also encouraging development. We looked at private development and how they were providing infrastructure and the O&M. We found that there was no real private development that was happening without government subsidies. And we felt like public parking is really a public infrastructure, and it's a tool to generate economic development. So based on what we found and based on our findings from council, we put together a number of policy objectives. This also includes information from our 2008 redevelopment plan. It includes national best practices. So we felt that the objectives of a holistic policy should be improving, maintaining the economic viability of the redevelopment area, promoting reinvestment and attracting new development to the redevelopment area, continuing to attract visitors to the redevelopment area, effectively utilizing our public infrastructure, minimizing our capital expenditure, and minimizing operations and maintenance costs. So we looked at our current model today. We have a shared model that is nearly all financed by the town of Gilbert. We did a community survey with approximately 4,000 responses. 55% of people rated Gilbert's parking availability as very good or good. In comparison to other cities, they rated us 64% as very good or good. And we also asked you, how did you feel about the Heritage Village Center shared parking policy? Is it working, is it not? 50% of you felt that it was working. But the key here is that only 33% of council surveyed believe that the Heritage Village Centered shared parking policy is sustainable for the next 10 years. So we understand that we really have to evolve as our district evolves. We did some pros and cons to the shared concept and a shared model. You know, there are certainly a lot of things that fit within those previous objectives. The cons really are the fact that we bear nearly all of the financial responsibility for building, operating, maintaining, replacing, and of course that managing parking also has a cost associated with it. So a parking policy really, in our research, has six main components: parking requirements, transit supportive design, parking pricing, parking districts, parking management strategies, and parking financing. In the survey that we sent you, we addressed areas within all six of these components. But it's really important to note that you can't make a decision in one component without affecting another component. So the example that we gave tonight is paid parking. So if we decide to implement paid parking, meaning that visitors pay, that anyone in the Heritage District, so that would be your businesses, visitors, employees, pay for parking as they're there, there is a direct effect on the residential area because people will likely park in residential neighborhoods where they don't have to pay. So we need to be very cognizant that if we implement paid parking, we really have to also then look at how we handle our residential parking to ensure that we're not impacting our residents. There are four categories that really shape that parking policy. We are currently, if you look at the definition from the National Parking Institute, we're really considered a rural area still, but we're moving towards the suburban area, and the reason is we're gaining additional office and additional multifamily that really moves us into that category. So for tonight's recommendations, we're focusing on those, knowing that we're continuing to densify and grow. So again, these were the parking policy components. We're going to go through each of them individually. The first three we believe we can get through pretty quickly. The last three really address your top areas of concern, and we feel that that's probably where you'll have most discussion. So that's why we ordered it this way. Our recommendations are made in various terms. So immediate, 0 to 18 months, near term, 3 years or less, midterm, 3 to 5 years, and long-term strategy, 5+ years. So as we look at parking requirements. This is really managing the amount of parking associated with new development, and it's an effective way to increase density in a downtown area. So our recommendations are retaining shared parking and reducing parking ratios in the midterm. So we'll go through each of those individually. So when we talk about retaining shared parking, we're talking about retaining a model where not every single business has to meet all of its parking requirements on its site, that there is a shared area for parking for the businesses, allowing them to build to their lot lines and densify within the district. So really when we think of this as a downtown versus like a neighborhood town center. We did a comparison of our benchmark cities and our surrounding cities, and all of them are using a shared parking model to establish that density. So this is our first iClicker question. You want to make sure your power button's on. And the question is, do you believe Gilbert should retain the shared parking model? Yeah. Okay. Okay, unanimous. We can move on from that. We will retain our shared parking model, or that's the direction at this point. The next item that we discussed was the, let me just get to this. Yes, reducing our parking ratios. So when you look at your parking ratios, you know, this is really a comprehensive program that examines occupancy and rate of absorption rates at various hours. So for example, there's a difference in peak hours between office and between a restaurant user. We also examine our own code, and we know that 67% of you felt that Gilbert should not have a different parking ratio requirement for businesses in the Heritage District. However, as it densifies, we really recommend returning to council with additional information and a study on what a reduction in parking ratio requirements could do to continue enhancing that density.
I think there might be some comment. Yes.
Yes.
Councilmember Cook.
Testing 1, 2, 3.
Thank you.
You know, the one thing that we've kind of chatted about in the past for the downtown is how much can we really pack in the downtown successfully? If we reduce the parking ratios where you can add more density to businesses, there's got to be a point where the lines cross and it doesn't make sense to go more dense. What analysis have we done to kind of look at, you know, what is dense and where is that limit? I mean, I know we're in the early stages, but I would hate to, you know, try to make some assessment without really having some data that says, you know what, we have 10 restaurants, going to 20 is way too much, or something like that.
Sure. So I would say one of the areas that addresses and begins to address this concern is the Kimley Horn parking study. If you look at the study, there's an area that looks at the various land use. So there were some assumptions made on how we would designate each parcel that we currently own, and looks at the parking ratio requirements as they are today and the need, and then gave recommendations on how much future parking we would need to either build or work with a private entity to build on their sites. I think the other thing that we would do, and why we're recommending this as a 3 to 5 years, is we're heading into a redevelopment plan update, and we realize that this will be a key component of that and part of an urban master plan for our community and understanding those densities and that need, and then also understanding how that stacking could look, so what that requirement would be.
Yeah, Mayor, Councilmember Cook, if I could just add on to that, there's several components that will dictate the amount of density that we could achieve down there. One being the available land for development or redevelopment. Next, the circulation system, the road, transportation, the means in and out of there, and then another key component of that being the parking with that, and how do you park that depending on what kind of additional uses you're going to bring in, and how do those get paid for. So it'll be a series of questions that an analysis that we'll have to do through the years as we look towards further development of the district and expanding that district to the south and to the north where those available parcels exist.
Since we're in study session, just feel free to, nobody needs my approval to speak. We want to be casual, but okay. If you guys get out of hand, I'll really.
Just throw your shoe at me. That works. Just kidding. You've never done that. That's just silly. But quick comment. I'm okay with this because I was one of these people that said we shouldn't have reduced parking requirements in the downtown versus other areas. And I would maintain that point. Now, assuming parking requirements are based on the actual estimated demand for parking based on the business and its use and all that. So if we feel like we're a little bit overboard on those requirements, I just suggest we look at it for the whole town rather than just adjusting it for the downtown. But if staff feels that we can reduce the requirements and still get what we need, I'm fine with that. I don't like having double standards. I'm sure everyone knows that about me, but that was my only concern. Just wanted to comment on that.
Amanda, just to define terms, so the ratio is square foot to parking availability?
Correct.
We're talking about?
Yes.
Okay.
Amanda, I have a couple questions.
Great.
So under the current requirements that we have for parking, how much excess parking would you say that we had? I mean, there's got to be a number, right? Or have we already sort of topped it?
Well, I think to answer your question, I remember when they did the study, as we looked at proximity to the restaurants, obviously the parking was more dense, but when you went outside of the, off of Gilbert Road, there's lots and lots of free parking still available.
I'm just wondering, ratio-wise, where are we?
Mayor, are you asking if we're in a surplus or not at this current time?
Yes.
We have a surplus currently in the north and the south, which we will talk about a little bit later, but our core, we have approximately, I believe it was about 235 spaces in surplus, and that does not include the yard development, and that does not include OSO, and that does not include the disposition of site A and B, which would remove 89 spots. So that is certainly one of the reasons why the second parking garage within that area is so imperative.
So what I hear is that we're getting to that point where there isn't any excess. And the reason I'm asking that is because we're driving a lot of special events in downtown on purpose. We want that density. We want that urban core feeling. We want people walking around. But what I'm hearing is if under our current ratios, we are already topping out, I think that will limit our ability to do special events at certain hours in the district, those peak hours where we know. And I don't want that necessarily to happen. I just think that that's a reality that we're dealing with. I also think, though, if we reduce parking requirements and there is, let's say, a headliner at Whiskey Row or a big event downtown, we will impact the residential piece again. That's another thing I think that will immediately be triggered. I also anticipate that a user at some point will come to us and say, look, I know that I'm going to put you over the max, so reduce my parking requirements. And I anticipate that that happens before we hit the 3 to 5 years. So my, I guess, ask of you all is, if this really is a midterm type discussion, if we continue to develop, and if the 8 acres, especially to the north, which we've talked about self-parking, I'm not sure we have the luxury of 3 to 5 years. I think that this needs to be a conversation had much sooner than that. So sorry it took a long time to get there, but I feel like there's a lot of pieces as part of that puzzle that would make sense for us to have that conversation ahead of time.
Thank you, Mayor. So what I'm hearing is that we should return within the immediate 0 to 18 months to really talk through this portion and the parking requirements once again. Okay, so we will change the question to say, do you want staff to return within 0 to 18 months?
Mayor, can I share a little case study with you?
Please.
Mark, you might remember this. A couple of years ago, when I was on the Constitution Week board, we thought we needed to move locations, and so we were thinking along the lines of Mayor Smith and Mesa, saying, well, what if we did it downtown and kind of block things off? Might have been part of some of those discussions. For us, the showstopper on that was the train, and how that really impacted being able to shut roads down and flow and things like that. So when we talk about, you know, big special events down there, parking's obviously a huge discussion, but that train is an absolute hard stop to having big, massive, you know, downtown events like Mesa does with Celebration of Freedom. And of course, they had to move north when light rail came through as well, and that's just the way it is. But it's a little case study. When we talk about special events and how we might be programming the downtown, when it comes to blocking off the road, you have a sort of a natural line there, and then it just goes north.
Well, I'm even thinking when we lit the water tower, I mean, I was amazed how many people we actually sort of squished into downtown. It's a small area. It really is. Right now, it's a small area. I anticipate that at some point we lengthen and spread a little bit in this area, but I think that's maybe beyond us.
Yeah, Mayor, Councilmember, Vice Mayor Taylor, excuse me. It really is an urban environment, and we need to think of it in terms of an urban environment where it's going to be tighter spaces, and when you do celebrations and events, and it's very common to hold them in urban environments or in your downtown, it's going to be a different experience than if we held it somewhere else, and that doesn't necessarily make it bad. It just means that there's certain accommodations we'll have to make in order to achieve that. But in talking about the rail and talking about the potential for our downtown, there are many variables that will play themselves out based on some things that are occurring locally and as well as regionally and statewide. We know that the rail line, the yellow alignment as it's referred to for the commuter rail that's being proposed within this state, is the rail line that comes through Gilbert, and we've begun those planning processes now. As you all are aware, that if that rail line, if that commuter rail should become a reality, to make sure that we maximize the potential benefit to our community as well as mitigate the impacts. But one of the things we're looking at as well is, would it make sense to depress those rail lines going through our downtown area? That would provide us with easier access to continue to push the development of the district now to the west, which is now effectively right now cut off because of that rail line. It also provides better emergency access. We will have more separated grade crossings between vehicular traffic and the train should there ever be an accident or a stoppage on the tracks, but then it also will free up some of that capacity within the district that gets compounded when we try to do special events or as we continue to create more density down there. So a lot of variables for us to weigh and evaluate and plan for as we move forward and maximize the value of our downtown.
I think that that's definitely a valuable conversation and probably one that we need to continue as a council. There's a substantial investment there, but I think we all can see immediately what the benefits to that might be, and it requires the partnership of lots of individuals and groups in order to make that happen. So without overusing the term, can we put that in a parking lot right now for a future conversation to happen sooner, I think, rather than later, at least in the next year? Maybe a year from now?
Yes, Mayor, Vice Mayor Taylor. We anticipate the federal record of decision to come down sometime around February,
right,
officially designating that as the alignment for the commuter rail station, at which time it will begin a series of work on behalf of the town and at the regional and state level specifically related to that topic. But it will factor into the redevelopment and the update of our redevelopment plan for the Heritage District.
And when you think about 20 years from now, we think about maybe Cooley Station being potentially that main thoroughfare coming through Gilbert. So I enjoy the conversation, but I'm thinking 20 years from now, it's really going to be a different conversation. I think we support the businesses. Major events, I think, is something that we talk about later, but I'd rather focus on the businesses. And supporting, you know, the parking and the structures for all that is
so are
really,
you saying don't have a conversation in
no,
the next
I
year
think
about
the
depressing tracks?
I think having a conversation sooner is better.
Oh, okay.
But I think when you talk about the major events, you know, with the South Regional Park, and again, maybe in 20 years from now, I think all that will probably change in my mind.
Yeah, I don't ever see the parade moving routes. I mean, things like that that are natural. Yeah. I mean, when we light our water tower, we're not moving the water tower to have the to have a water tower lighting. I think there will be some natural events that happen there. Are we going to get 20,000 extra people in downtown? No, that's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying I think special events, we will have to always factor in excess parking, if there is such a thing, but excess parking into that conversation.
Thank you. It looks like we have five iClickers for direction. If you could just press power once more, hit A or B. We just want to make sure that we're being as transparent as possible in this direction. Okay. So 67 yes, 33 no.
Okay. Do we need to clarify that then? To have it in the next 18 months? Okay, that's why I voted no, because I thought it said 3 to 5. So, do we want to have it? Should we re-vote that one?
Yes.
I thought it was a year and a half. So.
Yeah.
I just.
That's why I voted no.
Yeah, we voted no because, but you want to have it in the next 18 months.
I think
okay,
we're clear.
Sorry.
So next 18 months.
Okay.
Unanimous.
Well, let's just vote so that they have the record. I don't mean vote in the sense that
we're making a decision.
Like our town council. These are not permanent
direction.
Decisions. These are direction, yeah. One more person?
That's it.
Okay, unanimous. Thank you. Okay. The next topic, so the third area is transit supportive design. So this is really the idea that we need to have opportunities for alternative modes of transportation, getting to and from the Heritage District, that there are opportunities for reducing the need for private automobiles, for enhancing walkability and bikeability. We shared that Kimley Horn had delivered to our town a traffic and circulation plan in July 2015. Within that plan, there were a number of recommendations for improvement. That included such things as an addition of bike lanes, bikeways, a canal crossing, an examination of an extension to Cullimber Avenue, realignment of Ash. And we are recommending that we implement that and begin to implement those near to midterm, or immediate, excuse me, to near term. So 18 months to 3 years. We are also, and we'll go through talk these through each individually. We're also recommending that we implement wayfinding in the district immediately. Wayfinding really allows people to get to the public infrastructure quickly and into our district and enjoying the district. It allows us to really maximize the use. If they don't know that it's there, they're not utilizing it efficiently. So it's really about creating that efficiency, and we feel that we have this immediate need for wayfinding. One of those examples is the parking, the public parking that's located adjacent to the Gilbert Chamber building. That is not marked as public parking, and we continue to get that question from individuals of whether or not they can park there. So that's just one area that would truly benefit from signage. And, you know, as time goes on and the development in the district continues, there's certainly a desire for ride sharing, so an area for Uber, Lyft, taxis. What that would do, would it would allow those who are picking up and dropping off to get them off of the street, provide for safety so that they can have a designated area, they're not blocking traffic, and we also don't see them then staging in neighborhoods. So our first recommendation and what we would like direction on is, should we begin implementing Kimley Horn's recommendation for traffic and circulation?
I'm just trying to remember, on the circulation, when we talk about ASH, are you, is it in reference of having ASH go through the parking lot today, splitting it, driving it down south along the railroad tracks, going along the railroad tracks and punching out over on Cullimber?
So that particular item would be, sorry, Councilmember Cook, that particular item would be a study to determine if it goes straight from all the way down to the park and ride and across, if there's even a potentiality of taking that over the train tracks. It would look at a potential diagonal option for it, and just really understanding what is the most efficient and effective way to move cars and pedestrians through the Heritage District.
Okay.
So, quick huddle right here. We need to be reminded of what their recommendations were, because none of us actually remember.
Okay, so I would suggest that we come back within the next, in the immediate term then, to review all of those recommendations from Kimley Horn and go through them individually.
So you would like us, maybe what you could do is provide all that information via email to us as a council, and we can put it on as at the end of a council meeting, so we don't schedule an additional meeting, but in there under the administrative items, we can come back and give direction based on that one item.
Mayor, thank you. We can certainly do that.
Okay.
So the vote would then for economic development to bring back the Kimley Horn recommendations, share those with council, and then discuss those at a meetings in the immediate 0 to 18 month term. Great, unanimous. The next item that we are recommending on an immediate 0 to 18 month term is implementing wayfinding, which would include hiring a consultant to provide that wayfinding for us, bringing that out to the community, and then implementing it via creation of the actual signage.
My only comment is, I'd rather look at how we're going to handle the trash versus wayfinding. That's just my opinion. I think that's a bigger issue. I know this is not a trash discussion, but to me...
Are we at an either-or position as it relates to capacity for staff? Is that the concern?
Well, I don't know. I mean, if I think about priorities, I'd rather focus on the trash versus the wayfinding, to me. That's just my own knowledge of the downtown.
Mayor, Councilmember Cook, we proceeded with our stakeholder group for waste management in August, and we should have recommendations to council in January for that waste management and how we'll handle the trash. As far as capacity, we feel that getting an RFP out, you know, within the immediate term for wayfinding would then allow that consultant to proceed with their study so that we could then bring that to a stakeholder group prior to the end of this fiscal year and have recommendations prior to the end of June.
Can you tell me why we might need a consultant to help us provide? I'm just wondering, if is this something that's kind of obvious, like Bridget could go down there and say, I think a sign right here would be really helpful, or is this really something that you need? She spends a lot of time downtown, that's why I picked on Bridget. Is this really something that we need a consultant to identify spots for us?
Mayor, I believe, you know, when we look at a policy for wayfinding, it's much more than just determining where the signage goes, and there are experts who will be able to tie in that signage, the look, the feel, what materials are best, you know, how that impacts our costs long term, and of course the location, and there's some immediate suggestions that we can make and implement in-house with some of our sign group. But in the long term, how that ties into our overall Gilbert strategy for wayfinding, I believe that our recommendation has been to utilize a consultant.
So let me ask this question before Victor does. What are we looking at as far as how much it will cost to hire a consultant to outline this? Well, give us a ballpark. You're welcome.
We asked a consultant what their costs would be. We're currently working with a consultant for our trails, and they estimated approximately $30,000 for a comprehensive strategy. That does not include the actual creation, printing, hanging, putting up signage, installing it.
You know, I can find Joe's Barbecue today. You know, 10 years from now or maybe 20 years from now, it may be a different story.
I like the idea of maybe more clearly identifying public parking and things like that. I just don't, I mean, that was the example really that you gave us.
Sure.
Mayor, I'm with you. I appreciate the questions on that. I do think we need to do some wayfinding, but it's wayfinding light for me. I think it does help in circulation, but some of the previous wayfinding presentations seem a little bit overkill. So I don't think we need a consultant. I think if we just go wayfinding light, it will help with traffic and flow and things like that that are issues right now. But I don't think we need to go way over like we've seen before.
Mayor, I agree with you and Council Member, or sorry, Vice Mayor Taylor. I think some of the big things that everyone's looking for, it makes sense. And so, but I don't want, my biggest concern about getting into the business of trying to put every business's sign on there is we're going to have wars over who gets that space, because they're going to get limited really quickly unless we have these big monstrous signs that block traffic or bikers or people on foot. And I just, anyway, again, wayfinding light, and I'm also not a big fan of the consultant idea at this point.
Can you make a, I guess, a harder pitch on why we would, why a consultant, a 30,000, I mean, that's not small money when it comes to that you really only have a report at the end of it that gives you direction, but can you give me a harder sell, Amanda, on that? I mean, there's been a lot of conversations at the Heritage District meetings as well about this, so I need more.
Mayor, members of the council, could we maybe provide you at the same time we provide you with the Kimley Horn study on traffic circulation? We'll give you the scope of work that would be included in a wayfinding thing so we can better understand the complexity and the task at hand, and then maybe make a decision at that point if you'd like us to pursue a wayfinding light, or if we think that that actually is more complex than we're understanding at this point. Okay, then we'll provide that at the same time.
Things like parking here, well, we can do that already, right? That doesn't need a consultant to say, parking garage, turn right.
Right.
Right?
Mm-hmm. I think what they're saying, though, is they want everything to be aesthetically on the same page. So, yes, our internal town group can go put up a sign that says parking this way.
Right.
But I think we're looking to do some brand, from what I understand, we're looking to do some branding along with it.
Mayor, Councilmember Cook, that would certainly be one aspect to it. The other aspect is really understanding how people are currently moving through the district. I'm by no means an expert in wayfinding or pedestrian patterns, car patterns, traffic patterns, and that is certainly something that a consultant would bring to the table, is understanding that traffic flow, the pedestrian flow, and then of course things like height, you know, where, you know, what's the best height to hang a sign based on, you know, a person driving or walking, or I mean, there's a lot of questions that I'm just not simply an expert in, but I certainly can make a recommendation that we bring back our wayfinding and wayfinding light within the next 0 to 18 months while we bring back the Kimley Horn recommendations.
I mean, for me, it's about priorities again. I would love to know, again, focus to me as we've gone through our you know, efforts, as Patrick knows, focus was the number one item on the team when we went through this whole process, you know, 3 or 4 years ago. I'm just all about focus and, you know, getting things that we have priorities, get them done. So to me, I think the trash is more important than wayfinding, to me.
I agree that trash is a priority for us, and it sounds like you're already working towards bringing us an answer for that, and that's great. And I do think, because I do spend a lot of time in the Heritage District, that we do need some wayfinding, but I agree with the wayfinding light version. I'm not sure that we need a consultant. I might have an easier time swallowing that pill if I was real pleased with the last consultant report we got on the Heritage District, and I'm not 100% sold on the Kimley Horn report that we got or the presentation that we got from them, and I'm glad that you're going to bring back components of that for us. But I think, like Mayor said, if you bring us back a really good reason for that wayfinding and what it would mean for the Heritage District for us to move forward with that, I might have an easier time with that.
Councilmember Peterson, thank you. Yep. So bring it back 0 to 18 months. So 5 to 1. The next point in transit supportive design was providing staging areas for car sharing, like Uber, Lyft, taxi. Again, this is really a strategy to ensure safety for traffic circulation, and to ensure that these types of car sharing programs are not then staging in our neighborhoods. So the recommendation would be to begin providing a staging for car sharing in the district and looking at that option.
We had talked about, you know, right now we do have, you know, bus stops along Gilbert Road. Would this discussion also include maybe relocating that bus stop maybe off of Gilbert Road and maybe by the where our park and share ride is? Maybe that could, so I'm just trying to think of maybe redirecting that bus coming down maybe Ash down to another location instead of pick up and drop off of Gilbert Road. Could that be part of this study as well?
Councilmember Cook, we could certainly look at the bus. I mean, that certainly is part of a transit supportive design,
right?
and understanding that we could tie that in with car sharing.
I mean, I would like to add that discussion to maybe rethink about where that bus stop is instead of on Gilbert Road, but maybe a little bit off of Gilbert Road.
Eddie, I love your enthusiasm. We keep trying to go like this because we're trying to have this conversation, and
Well, I think we're going to talk about, you know, this transit. I'm just saying, why don't we include talking about the bus stop?
That requires, you know, a regional conversation, which we can totally have, but we really do need to get to some decisions like this rather than the big stuff. And that's big too. And I agree with you. I've actually been talking about getting buses off of Gilbert Road for a while as we had this discussion. But
Mayor, yeah, just a quick question. Is a taxi or Uber or Lyft, are they allowed to use a bus pullout, or is that illegal?
Yeah, I don't. Councilmember Peterson, I do not know that at this moment.
They can't. So they literally have nowhere to, like, pull off to get people in and out of the car without.
They can go in any public parking lot and pick people up. We don't want them just pulling over on the street. And we don't have actually any bus turnouts except for by the park and ride in the Heritage District. There's no bus pullouts on Gilbert Road in our Heritage District.
What's the thinking behind them needing a specific staging area? To Mayor Daniels' point, if they can use the parking lot, the reason that doesn't work, as long as we have enough parking. I'm just curious about that.
Yeah. And add to that, does it take up spaces that we areas that we would use for parking.
Yeah.
But it just take away from those.
Mayor, Councilmember Peterson, they can and do pick up and drop off just about anywhere right now, even on Gilbert Road, on Vaughan, on Page. What would be in our best interest is to provide a dedicated area to where we could kind of consolidate that and maybe a couple spots within the district to then not create traffic circulation issues by having them stop wherever they'd like to.
Would the idea be to use existing parking areas and just demark or annotate a certain area for that purpose? Is that kind of what we're thinking?
We'd look at all the various areas and then determine what's the best, least impact on the district, most efficient way to handle it.
I'm just trying to figure out, of course, I'm trying to figure out cost here. And if we're able to use the existing resource more effectively by making a specific area for this, I'm totally in support of that. But I'm just thinking, why not use that rather than build some new structure or something just for that purpose? So that's just my feedback.
Well, it could even be as simple as designating 15-minute parking in on a side street, like by Zinberger or something, where right now people can actually park there. But you could make it a 10-minute or 5-minute parking zone, and then that's a quick pickup place. What you don't want to have happen is have them barely pull over. They're still on Gilbert Road in a lane of traffic, and people are jumping in and out of cars, but that's what's happening in downtown right now.
Two comments on that. One is, when I went to one of the Heritage District meetings at the Chamber, our police officers mentioned that the parking next to Oregano's, that might be a good spot for those parking spaces to go away in the future. So that might be a spot to consider for this kind of staging, and especially because that's right across the street from where Whiskey Row will open, which will provide a spot for people to really need Uber and Lyft to get home from. So I'm thinking that that might be a good place to look, is right there. So it might kill two birds with one stone, actually. Take those off as permanent parking spaces and give the spot for the Lyft and Uber.
So this would be for us providing staging. We would then examine all of those options and provide car sharing within our district.
And with all of these things, Maddie, you're coming back to council with where the staging will be before it's actually implemented.
Mayor, that is correct. So this is an immediate need that we feel we should examine right now.
Okay. I know, I'm really buttoned.
Okay, 5-1. The third area of a comprehensive parking policy.
I was just saying how fun it was that I hadn't been outvoted once yet. I'm kind of freaking out here.
And Mayor, on that point, or related to that point, the direction to staff has been non-unanimous. Attached to the minutes of this meeting will be a table or a chart so that the public would be able to see the non-unanimous direction given. And this is, just in the interest of transparency and making the public aware of who gives which direction to staff. Thank you.
We should probably start saying outpolled because we're not voting. But anyway.
So the third aspect of a comprehensive parking policy is parking pricing. And what this is paid parking by a visitor, employee, customer, consumer in a designated area. This is not a sole cost recovery model. And really, in this case, parking pricing is really meant to manage our parking inventory. We asked you, should parking be free to Heritage District visitors? 50% of you felt that it should, and approximately 33% of you were unsure. So for those of you who are unsure, we did a comparison of other cities. Again, these are the cities that we benchmark ourselves against. These are the cities that surround us and that, you know, our downtown competes with their downtown. So as you look at this chart, you'll notice that majority of them offer free public parking, except for in the circumstances that there's a major attraction or a university located in there. And again, under those circumstances, they're using paid parking to manage their parking inventory, not solely as a cost recovery model. That said, we will talk about some cost recovery models later. So this is just, should people be paying to park in the district? Our recommendation is that based on the benchmark cities, based on our comparative cities, based on the cost of managing parking, we are saying no paid parking in the immediate term, so 0 to 18 months. But we would like to revisit this within the near term, so 3 years or less, as we move through our redevelopment plan update in fiscal year 2018. And as we have additional developments come online, there are three particular areas, you know, so visitor, paid visitor parking, paid, so visitor being user, employee, visitor, and looking at paid convenience parking and paid employee parking. So this is simply asking, do we want to proceed with no paid parking pricing within the next 18 months? We have a 5-to-1 unpaid parking. Our second recommendation within paid parking, again, this is as we continue to densify, as we have additional developments come online, we really feel like there's an opportunity to revisit this with council. So our question is, do you want staff to come back to you with the paid parking pricing in the near term? So that's the 1 to 3 years.
Can I make a quick comment? Here's the thing. It does help manage inventory because people consume more at lower prices than they do at higher prices, of course. And so you get overuse and you get undervalued infrastructure when it's free. And so furthermore, you create a situation where the private sector has no incentive to provide the resource because they can't make money doing it because the competition's doing it for free. So I won't get going. I could go on all kinds of economic principles. I know I'd bore everyone to tears, but I will just say this. If we do think users ought to be paying at least some of the cost of their own parking, I don't think waiting is going to be, or at least I would say the near term. Bottom line is that the district's growing now. Things are good now. This is the easiest time to have this conversation. If things change, this all goes out the window. I'm just saying. So that's my comment.
Testing the mic.
I'm sorry.
I have a comment. Now, I'm not sure what options you're thinking about providing as it relates to paid parking. Could one of the options be, because we're in the redevelopment district, that there might be a possible, I'm not saying fee or additional, we'll call it light tax for infrastructure purposes on all the consumption that people do as they come down there, like a consumption, you know, infrastructure tax just for the Heritage District that could potentially, I'm not saying 100% cost recovery, but it could be used for that recovery. Is that one of the options that you might bring?
Mayor, Councilmember Cook, that is, we will talk through financing options. So that would solely be under the financing portion of parking. This is simply parking pricing. Do you charge for parking or do you not charge for parking?
So
I had the same thought. I think I know where you were going. It wasn't necessarily about that. But if we created, let's say, a parking district in downtown Gilbert, which is a legal district, right, under the state law, we could charge, let's say, 25 cents per receipt, per purchase, basically, in downtown Gilbert. And that way you're not paying at the garage point of sale, which is where it's really inconvenient because you can get into a line and you have to remember your ticket and all those different things. But instead it's just a, hey, as a consumer, there's going to be something on my receipt next to the sales tax that says parking district 25 cents. Or I'm just throwing a number out there because I just want it to be out there. Not necessarily a you're paying by the hour and keep track of your ticket and make sure you have it. Is that a reasonable, and maybe it's that there's a threshold if your receipt's over $5. I mean, there's a lot of different ways that you can implement that where everybody gets a piece, is paying a piece of it, but you're not inconvenienced by paying that piece of it. Does that make sense?
Certainly. Thank you, Mayor Daniels. Later in our presentation, we talk about an option for within sales tax. Yes, something very similar later in the financing portion.
Tell me what this conversation looks like. You come back to us, let's just say we say 3 years, you come back to us and we end up having this conversation again.
Yes, so thank you, Mayor. This would then be an opportunity for us to look at what that actual management, so if we want to proceed with a paid model, what the management of that paid model would look like, what the actual cost recovery would be for it, and you know what the cost of implementing that type of a model would be.
Do we anticipate the district 3 years from now being in a very different place than what it is today? When I say very different, I mean like...
Mayor, based on our research, the only areas that we have found, you know, in comparison for our benchmarks and for our surrounding cities that are charging for parking in this method, either have a university located there or a major attraction. So Huntington Beach, for example, is charging because of the beach. There are other areas that have a stadium located in there, and then they charge for parking. And again, it's not utilized as a cost recovery model. This is solely utilized as a management of your parking inventory.
So would it be fair to assume that it might have an impact on us economically in the area if we were to charge?
Mayor, Councilmember Candlin, that would be a fair assumption. Yes, vote, please. Thank you. Mayor, council members, I think that this is a good opportunity to discuss potentially the, revisiting this in the short term. Is part of this the term? Is it simply the time frame? Is it the options? Can you help us with some of that direction, please?
Yes, let's have that discussion. Is your vote based on you want to delay the conversation or have it sooner?
Well, mine is to revisit that, we'll call it parking district option. I mean, I'd rather have something like that then versus, you know, putting a parking meter or we have.
So we're asking about time frame. Was it the time frame that you liked that time frame? 3 years?
Well, again, I think we should have the other discussion sooner. I'd like to understand that one.
Which other?
Before. District. Yeah, I would like to have that. To me, sounds more plausible to have that discussion sooner than later. Then versus this one.
So you would forego this conversation to have a parking district type discussion?
Yes, for me, I would do that.
Okay, that helps.
I agree with that. I had voted that I was fine with yes with this time frame because I'm I want to see where the district goes before we continue with pricing.
And I said no because I felt like it was too short of a time frame. I feel like 5 years from now we might be in a better place, but 3 to me is just too soon.
So I'm in the no column, partly because of that. Too soon, we need to let the dust settle a little bit, but I don't know that I'm really high on paid parking because we don't have a major attraction. The other big thing that maybe it's concerning to be revolved, it'll push parking into those neighborhoods if we, you know, put a fence around it. That, but I'm always open to the discussion. Maybe I'm wrong on that. Maybe there's ways to mitigate that, but that's why I voted no.
So you'd prefer to have this conversation in 3 years?
Partly because I won't be here.
I think you've just been recruited for the general plan update, so that's good.
You have like 5 weeks.
I think it's healthy to have to continue to have the discussion. I don't, if it's going to impact the town economically, then I would say continue with the free parking model. So.
I was a yes because I was a yes talking about it even sooner. So, but I know there's others with the opposite vote. So I don't know if we want to try and re-vote with a longer time frame and see what happens, but that might go somewhere.
Does that change anyone's vote? Changes mine. Does that change yours? Have it in a longer time frame?
I'm okay having any discussion about
five. We're at 1 to 3 years if we want to move it.
Or after 3.
3 to 5.
Okay.
Okay.
3 to 5, and we can revote.
So we will revisit paid parking within the midterm 3 to 5 years.
Okay.
Great. Thank you.
I'm kidding.
Yeah.
The fourth area for us to review is parking districts. So parking districts are a tool, and it's a development of parking and transportation within a given area. We looked at we broke the Heritage District up for the purpose of discussion into 3 areas. So north of the canal. Kind of the core, so south of the canal, north of the tracks, and then south of the railroad. We asked you a number of questions just in regards to adequacy and convenience. So the first question we asked was, do you feel that the area described as the north was adequate and convenient? We would certainly agree in this regard. We have no businesses that are utilizing an administrative use permit, so they're not utilizing our shared parking, and we have 600 plus stalls. We asked if you felt that parking in the area described as the core Heritage District is adequate and convenient. Approximately 50% of you felt that it was both adequate and convenient, and then 33% felt it was convenient but not adequate. We believe that the addition of the second parking garage will ensure that it's both adequate and convenient. But at this moment, in the core of the district, we have a surplus of 236 stalls. That includes the AUPs, the administrative use permits for both Ticket Force and Whiskey Row. However, it does not take into account what happens to parking, so the reduction of parking by 89 spaces as Site A and B are developed. Nor does it include the associated necessary parking for those sites for the yard or OSO. Those locations are currently utilizing, through their administrative use permits, the site to the north of the canal as part of their parking inventory. So certainly that garage is just imperative to bring online for that area. We also asked if you felt that the area described as South Heritage District is adequate and convenient. We had pretty much a full split here. What we wanted to share with you just for informational purposes is that currently at this moment all businesses in that southern portion are able to park their own business on site. So they're not utilizing an administrative use permit. However, Hanna Commercial Development, which is located adjacent to GCM Liquors, they have an administrative use permit to utilize 24 spaces within 1,000 feet of their site. We know that there's on-street parking at West Washington and West Park, which would not be located directly in front of residents. And there's also 80 public parking spaces at the Chamber directly across from them. What's really imperative for this area is just to continue to monitor the impact as those businesses in the area grows, as we develop the land on the northwest corner of Gilbert and Elliott, and just continue to ensure that the parking numbers are ample.
What is going to be at the GCM site last time, or on their property? Last time, I don't think we had a user.
They do. They don't have a user yet. They are. It's a restaurant use and office on top. But they. We talked to them. Was it about a month ago? A couple weeks ago, and they do not have a user signed at this point. We also asked a couple of other questions, like. Should Gilbert institute an employee parking policy that requires businesses to have employees park in designated areas? Overwhelmingly, about 50% of you said not sure. We put together a pros and cons list for you to help understand this. So really the pro in our mind, you know, we're trying to manage our parking supply and the convenience for those who come to our district to enjoy our district. We have approximately 1,300 employees in the Heritage District. Realizing that not all 1,300 are there at the exact same time, but they certainly impact the convenience parking. So you have employees who are parking closest to businesses. You'll see that at 8 o'clock in the morning, that some of those areas are full, and it's certainly not from visitors. So what an employee parking model does is it provides a specific location where employee parkers can be accommodated within the district. It provides, you know, a free use, frees convenient spaces for the visitor and customers. We feel that it increases safety measures. So if you're a server walking out from your shift at the end of the night, and you're walking out with a group of people to the same area, and you have cash in your pocket, it certainly increases that safety. We've had some concerns about the top of Ash Street parking garage with a large group of teenagers who hang out there, and we've had, you know, residents and businesses voice some concern. We feel that that area as a designated parking for employees could certainly mitigate some of those issues. And of course, you know, the cons to this is that we really need to look into an active parking management mechanism for enforcement and really get buy-in from our businesses. We did meet with a handful of our restaurateurs and asked them about employee parking. They were all very supportive of this. Their biggest concern was safety. So if we are putting them in an area that's further away from the business, ensuring that it's well-lit and a safe place for their employees. We also asked if Gilbert should institute a residential district in existing Heritage District neighborhoods. You know, that the main portion of that is simply, you know, to benefit the residents by preventing spillover, but it would need a mechanism for enforcement. So our recommendations is to do a pilot employee parking program for the top level of the Ash Street garage. You know, what benefits, see what kind of spots are freed up from that, and understand what that would take to roll out a program. So that would be immediate, 0 to 18 months. We would then come back to council with those results and an evaluation of a comprehensive employee parking model for the Heritage District. So that would be near term, so 1 to 3 years. And we would evaluate residential parking and the potentiality of having a designated residential area midterm, so 3 to 5 years. That really corresponds with all of the development that's coming online. So that Hanna Commercial Center, which is near Lacey Track, that also corresponds with Whiskey Row also, and the Yard, which are on the northeast side of Gilbert and Vaughn. And there is certainly a multifamily and single family that is located in that area that could potentially be impacted. So we just want to be cognizant of it and mitigating those problems before they happen.
I had a quick question on the designated employee parking areas. What kind of concept are we talking about here? Are we talking about a certain number of spots for designated for each specific business, like Oregano's has spots labeled for Oregano employees? Are we talking a general employee parking regardless of which business area? And then my other follow-up to that is, are regular folks able to park in those if they can't find anywhere else? And if the employees can't find anywhere else, are they allowed to park outside of that? My number one concern with this is just the versatility of each spot is lost now. The moment you start marking up specific spots for specific uses, you've excluded it for some other use. And so you sort of shrink your usable inventory in a sense, because some of it's, now you're kind of guessing and you can't, you know, utilize each space for multiple purposes, and I'm worried about that. But anyway, help me out there if you can. Sorry, I'm rambling a little now.
No, Mayor, thank you, Mayor Councilmember Peterson. Part of implementing a pilot program would really be to understand that impact. Again, we want to implement it on the Ash Street Garage. See, you know, we really envision that certainly other people could park there if there's no parking. It's really to get our employees out of that those surface lots directly adjacent to the businesses where we really want our visitors to be able to park. Again, the idea is that they park quickly and then are out of their car and enjoying our district, which means that they're spending more time and hopefully spending additional dollars.
Amanda, how would you propose to monitor that?
At this point, thank you, Vice Mayor Taylor. At this point, we've talked about kind of an ambassador program, so the businesses helping us in monitoring it themselves, really promoting to their employees that importance, talking to the employees at their meetings and why we're instituting this and trying to help educate them would be our first step of implementing a program like this.
And it would be free during the pilot program?
Vice Mayor Taylor, yes, we intend for employee parking to continue to be free until we revisit paid parking as a whole.
Mayor, I feel like the businesses already have an incentive to make sure there's convenient parking for their customers, and I don't know. I hate to dictate to them. I'd rather, I think I'm open to a pilot program. I know we're going to vote. I'm just talking here, but I might be open to a pilot program, but I have a lot of concerns about the effect of this.
I was going to say a long, long, long time ago when I worked at Williams-Sonoma, long, 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 long time ago, they told us park on the second floor of X parking garage as an employee. That's where the employees park. And if there wasn't a spot there, I found another one. But for the most part, we all parked in the same general area because we were, I think as an employee, you do that. If your boss says, hey, go park in a certain area, you do your best to make that happen. And I don't think it's a dictation. I think it's a, hey, this is a lot more convenient and safer if you're all walking out together to the same spot, to the same lot. I don't know that there's a mandate.
I would prefer that kind of a model where we're talking with them, doing the PR, helping them understand the importance of it, but then asking them to make that directive. I don't know if I like this hard, fast, this spot is for this, this spot is for that. Anyway, that was just my thought. Thank you, Mayor.
Mayor, Councilmember Peterson, that is certainly the intent, is that it would be a shared area. Again, an area that all of the employees know that they can park there. Right now, there just isn't any kind of a designated area for employee parking, and this will allow our businesses to direct their employees to a certain area and free that particular convenient space up.
Could we label them something like recommended employee parking space area or something like that? You don't have to. So then there's no enforcement at all. Okay.
It's social, you know.
All right. Okay.
For a pilot, I mean, you want to see how it works.
In a former life, I have waited tables at restaurants and bars, and a long, long, long time ago. And it was always suggested, and not set up by, in the Heritage, like the Heritage District in any means, but very large parking areas where it was always suggested that the staff park the furthest away so that your customers could get to the building easily and quickly. A happy customer makes for a happy waitress, because you make more in tips that way if your customers come in happy. Same thing in retail. If they come in happy, that's how it's going to be. I don't say we mandate it. I say that we suggest. And I love the idea of using the top floor of the garage, because we went up there to take pictures of the water tower when it was purple. And it's not just teenagers. There's people in car clubs driving up there and sitting and hanging out. There were people sitting on the edge of the wall and not young, mid to late 20s maybe. So I think it's fix two situations that we're having, and the further away from the restaurants, that's further away being at the top of the garage. So I think it's a great suggestion. The bumps going up through the garage are a nightmare, so the employees are probably going to get annoyed with having to drive over those now going upstairs to the garage. If you haven't been in there recently, they're not easy on a Mini Cooper. They're big. They're big. But I think those are good suggestions. And again, I think it's on their honor to do it with their staff.
They're called calming. They're calming strips.
So, Amanda, do you have, what about the east side? Is there, you know, what are we going to do with the businesses on the east side? I don't see them parking and then walking that far over. I mean, are we going to do the same thing for the east side business?
Councilmember Cook, there's certainly an opportunity to do that as we build that second garage as well on that east side. I think it continues, again, it's not a mandate that they have to park in the garage. It's an opportunity to centralize where employee parking can be located. I think the education program, though, that we provide happens for both the east and the west side of Gilbert Road, and sharing with our businesses that the critical nature of their employees parking a little further and parking together in the same area.
So my question would be, you would think the businesses would always encourage that anyways. I guess my question is, why are we wanting to, decide to do this? Because at the end of the day, the businesses are going to want, you know, if I want more customers to be close to my business, I would educate my own employees to do that. So I'm not convinced yet. I mean, I like the idea, but it seemed like the businesses would drive it themselves instead of the town, you know, driving that.
Councilmember Cook, part of an employee parking program is providing a designated area. So right now you can certainly say park as far, but having a designated area enhances that opportunity for employees to park in those locations. And in the one-on-one meetings I've had with the merchants since coming into this role, that certainly employees parking in prime spots is continues to come up as a point of conversation with each individual I've met with. And none of them have certainly pointed fingers to the other businesses, but I think just having some more conversations as a group and reiterating that importance of maximizing that convenience would just simply be beneficial to the district.
I'm just wondering if we can't couple this education piece with some personal safety conversations. Maybe our police department can provide some personal safety tips along with, hey, this is kind of why we want you to be together as well. Yes, we want you to allow for close parking for customers, but also we want you guys to be safe. I mean, at the end of the night, you want people walking out in a group, not you're parked over here and you're parked over there. And, you know,
Mayor Daniels, I love that idea, and we'll certainly be able to pull that together with the pilot program. So the question, don't forget to press your power button, is should staff implement a pilot employee parking program for the top level of Ash Street Garage in the immediate term? Okay. Thank you for the direction. The next recommendation that we're making in regards to parking districts is to evaluate a comprehensive employee parking. So once we have gone through the pilot program, coming back to you within 1 to 3 years and really looking at a comprehensive employee parking strategy and what that would look like for the Heritage District. So the question is, would you like...
I have a question on this just real briefly. Does it make more sense to, and maybe this is what we're talking about, but does it make more sense to come back with the report on the pilot, and then we can decide if we want to look at something more comprehensive? Is that the same thing?
The report on, Councilmember Peterson, the report on the pilot would certainly come before that with some additional direction.
You know, I'd rather see that through before we start talking about the next thing, is all I'm saying.
Mayor, Councilmember Peterson, we can certainly curtail this until our pilot program is completed, and then, depending on its success, provide a recommendation to return with a comprehensive policy, depending on its success. Or a lessons learned, certainly. Thank you. We're good here. Yep. So based on the pilot, and its success and lessons learned, we would come back in the immediate term. Okay, unanimous, thank you.
It's just to be contrary. Hey, Dan. Amanda's doing a great job, don't you think? She's earning her money tonight.
You should have seen me over the weekend working on this. The last portion of the parking district is evaluating residential parking, and we would like to do that midterm. Again, the midterm, the reason why we selected 3 to 5 years was that that really correlates with all of the developments coming online on the east side of Gilbert Road, or on the east side, and then Hanna Commercial Development as well, and understanding. So as we understand the impact of those, we will then be able to present the findings of that impact to council and make a recommendation based on that. So we'd like to bring it back to 3 to 5 years.
Hey, Amanda, so how far outside of the parking district would you go? I mean, what is the definition of residential in terms of area? Is it outside the boundaries, or are you talking residential inside the boundary?
We would immediately look at the area inside the boundaries, but certainly could extend that past depending on what we're, you know, what trends we're seeing. If you look at the map.
Can you hear me? To me, that makes sense.
If you look at the map here, so these are where we're having developments come online. So we've got Whiskey Row, we've got Oso here, we've got the Yard. One of the concerns is that this area, and certainly even slightly past the boundaries, may experience an impact. And then, of course, with Hanna Commercial Development, some of the impact that could happen in the Lacey Tract area. We wouldn't, in the immediate term, foresee that this impacting further outside. But certainly the eastern portion, we could see that extending past the boundaries. So it would just be a matter of examining, you know, what that impact is as it continue, as those developments continue to come online.
Well, just my opinion is we should look outside, because if, and I hope we don't do a paid parking model, but if that does happen to go in, that's where traffic is going to spill out, and that's where this thing is going to have a lot of meaning. So I think it makes sense to fold that into the study to a certain degree.
Thank you, Vice Mayor Taylor.
I just wanted to make sure I'm clear on what we're talking about here. Are we talking about the residential developments? There's some redevelopment that's being proposed, some new product that may be coming online that's more dense. Are we talking about parking for those residences, or are we talking about the potential spillover from the downtown area into the residential areas because of the density increasing?
Council Member Peterson, we're talking about managing that spillover from developments that are happening, so that we would potentially have to designate the on-street parking in that area as residential only.
Okay, thank you.
I think, though, there is potential for residential spillover, particularly in the new parking garage as well, because of its proximity to some of the multifamily. You will only get one or two spots per unit, and there's four people living there, then you end up with potential spillover. So I think we do need to examine it really from both directions and rather just one. But I also don't think we should wait to evaluate it, because if we're talking about changing the ratios, which we discussed earlier, and also the traffic and circulation recommendations, and if we are talking, as we have been internally, about changing some of the residential requirements when it comes to the redevelopment of the residential piece, I think this will have a huge impact on that. And those three things are going to come within 0 to 18 months. So I actually think this needs to be moved up to coincide with those discussions.
Mayor, thank you.
And I think, you know, the district lofts could be that first potential spillover into that residential, because we don't know what that occupancy and vacancy would be. And as they have folks coming that want to visit and they're running out of their own guest parking, they'll end up right there on the street. So,
Mayor, Councilmember Cook, thank you. We will make our recommendation to return with information on a residential parking program then within the immediate term, 0 to 18 months. Great, that is a unanimous decision. Thank you for your direction. The fifth portion of a comprehensive parking strategy is, you know, ultimately, how do you manage your parking? So how are you managing your availability of inventory, the convenience, how we're pricing it and financing it? We asked the question, should on-street parking be preserved in the Heritage District? 50% said that they were unsure. We asked, do you think we should implement a uniform curb lane on-street parking management policy? Currently, in regards to curb lane management, we do have some 15-minute takeout type zones and delivery zones. Based on the I don't know responses, some of this is more returning with additional education. But the first item really is important, as there are a number of other communities that have an interactive parking tool for staff to manage parking supply. It manages parking supply counts, administrative use permits, parking commitments per development agreements, and provides live real-time information for staff, for executive leadership and council to utilize. It can also provide dynamic maps for us to see what parking is being utilized and where. Currently, all of this information is being gathered by staff and put into an Excel spreadsheet. So, you know, the information is only as good as we, you know, can frequently update it. So that would be our first recommendation, is that interactive tool. We would also suggest coming back to council for a master plan for uniformity and consistency for on-street parking. So determining what that need is for on-street parking and then the look and feel of it, that would happen immediate to near term. So 0 to 18 months to probably about 2 years.
Sorry, Amanda, so you're saying that master plan would be specific only to on-street parking?
Correct.
Okay.
Thank you, Mayor. The last item would be a use of best practices for curb lane management immediate to near term. So one of the greatest areas of focus for us when it comes to curb lane management, so there's a number of areas, and certainly we would bring back information and education about this. But the greatest area of concern for us right now is delivery zones. There are not a vast number of delivery areas in the Heritage District. So what you have are companies parking their trucks right in the middle of the street and people having to drive around them. And so we really want to examine, again, similar to having an area for drop-off and pickup for car sharing, this would be a similar strategy, but, you know, for deliveries and that takeout and understanding how we're moving people through. And that would happen, you know, in the immediate term.
Amanda, what's the interactive parking tool? Jeremy, what's an interactive parking tool?
Councilmember Canlin, so the tool, so right now, for example, I think the best way I can explain this is right now we are individually mapping how many parking spaces are available in each of our lots. We keep a spreadsheet of which administrative use permits are being designated to each parking lot. Anytime an administrative use permit comes before the Redevelopment Commission, before staff, I have to look and see who else is designated spaces within there. And it's a very rigorous and labor-intensive process. An interactive tool would just be an online web-based tool that allows us to input all of that information, and rather than me charting it by hand, it becomes an interactive, immediate, real-time tool to provide us that information and maps of our parking.
Thank you.
Cost?
Can I ask what, first of all, we have GIS mapping tools. Is there any potential for using some of that to help with this? That's one. And two, what kind of cost, you know, are we looking at for something like this? I love technology, but, you know, everything has a limit to what it should cost, so.
Mayor, members of council, my name is Dan Henderson. I'm the Economic Development Director for the town. As it relates to the GIS mapping, absolutely, GIS mapping is a tool that can be used. The challenge with the GIS mapping tool is that it grabs the geography. We can input the layer. It has a lot of staff management associated with it. The dynamic nature of the tool, in this case, it shows real time. It allows people to model it out for themselves. It constantly shows a real time nature. And again, as we look at the best practices for managing parking in the downtown, our peers, neighboring communities, downtown associations all recommend the use of a tool of this nature. The general cost, because that often is a secondary question, what's the cost of something like this? It's a customized tool. It's built once and then ultimately maintained. The general cost is about $40,000 to build the tool, and then an ongoing maintenance cost, you know, of maybe $1,000 annually. The what's subjective at this point is the annual maintenance cost. But we've been reassured that it's a minimal cost. We just don't have that cost at this time.
Dan, is that tool just for the Heritage District, or can be used throughout the entire municipal planning area?
Councilmember Canlin, that tool could absolutely be customized for the entire town. The cost would change significantly in order to model out the entire community, but it absolutely could be modeled for the community.
So, since its cost is related to its customization, as we build new structures or add new parking, is it going to have to be updated and then a new cost to recustomize it for that? And so what kind of ongoing are we looking at for that? Or is that the $1,000 a year you were talking about?
Councilmember Peterson, that's the $1,000 that I'm talking about. So what they would do is they would take the thing that might impact the overall cost of that tool is if, to Mayor Daniels' earlier point, expanding the boundaries of the Heritage District, increasing the size, albeit north, south, east, west, et cetera, that might bring with it additional maintenance costs. But for decades, the redevelopment area has been defined as a, you know, essentially a third of a mile, 260 acres.
You know what I'd really love? My big wish list on this is, and I know if we poll yes on this, it's going to come back for an official vote later, and that's, well, wait a minute. That's under 40,000. So would that even come back to us for an official council vote if we give direction on this?
We would ultimately want to bring it back to council, Councilmember Peterson, just so that you have the understanding of what staff is doing. Procurement regulations might suggest that administratively we might be able to do that. But again, because of the dynamic nature of the downtown, the use of a new tool of this nature to manage parking from now in perpetuity, we'd certainly want Mayor and Council's feedback on that.
So my wish list is, and not that everyone wants to do my wish list, that's, I'm sure it's not, but I would love to see, if we could see that it was actually saving us money because of the staff hours that we're saving and it keeps us from having to add bodies or something like that, that sure would go a long way to convincing me of the value of the tool. Anyway.
All of the direction that we're giving today will need to come back to council for an actual council action. So I just want to make sure that's clear, that we're giving direction and that that direction will frame what comes back to us for a vote. But especially for the public, I want to make sure everybody knows we're not, this is not a final conversation.
Thank you, and absolutely correct, Mayor Daniels.
So Dan, tell me, what is the number one problem we're solving with this tool that you need right now? I just need one.
It's just the overall management of parking in the Heritage District.
Like, if we made a policy that says we're going to remove on curb parking. Let's say we made a policy. My question is, you know, as it relates to your management, that's one less thing to look at, I'm assuming.
Correct.
I mean, if we made a policy like that, is the tool become less value if we do these policy adjustments? That's my question. Are there policies that you're looking from us to make that may not need to have this tool?
Understand the nature of the question. The single benefit that a tool, an interactive tool of this nature provides to us, to you, to the town, is real-time data as it relates to parking.
Dan, as you're looking to the tool, one thing I would hope that the tool would be able to do is make data available to the public real-time, not having to ask you for reports, or if there's some way that we can, you know, use that, the business could see it or contribute or comment or something like that. We could just tap into the intelligence of the community. Once we put the inventory, get some feedback, the more we can share that data would be great.
Vice Mayor Taylor, that's the intent behind the tool, is to make it an interactive tool. It'd be published on our website. It'd be something that anyone could use, anyone could look at, and be able to, as we often forecast, what is your demand for parking? This tool would be available to those developers, property owners, et cetera. So that's the purpose behind the tool.
I think you're hearing some trepidation from all of us on this tool. Why don't you come back to us at a future time? Let's have some really in-depth conversations with GIS. I know that they have a tall pile of work orders already ahead of this, but perhaps this is something that could be implemented. I mean, when I saw Mark Kramer's report on GIS at the retreat, their capacities, I think, are more than what any of us anticipated. I'm just wondering if we can explore some of those internal options before we go ahead and move forward with something like this. Does everybody?
Mayor Daniel, council members, we will then ask our recommendation to be returning to council in the immediate term with options, looking at our GIS mapping, and of course examining, regardless if it's an internally built or externally built tool, what type of, what it really saves the town in regards to time and dollars. So I'm going to hit start polling. Thank you all. We have a unanimous decision, and we will return with that information in the immediate term.
Just to confirm, based on all these decisions that we're making, Mike, you referenced some report that's going to be attached to the minutes that will have these questions and the answers. If we could make sure that all of the questions have been revised prior to the publicity of that report, I think that that would be good.
Yes, thank you, Mayor.
Since we are voting on something different than what we see up there.
Mayor Daniel, council members, we have one of our staff members currently typing in that information. He's actually listening to our presentation. He's typing the information in real time for us and the answers and decisions that have been made or the direction that's been given tonight so that we can review it quickly before we wrap this all up.
That's funny. I thought he was working on fantasy football the whole time. I'm really glad to know. I'm teasing you. I know that you are engaged in this conversation.
The second portion of that recommendation was through the 2018 redevelopment plan update, provide a master plan for uniformity and consistency for on-street parking. Should we return to council with information regarding a master plan for uniformity and consistency of on-street parking? I will open up the polling.
Amanda, can you just
and discussion,
define
real
quick the scope of on-street parking? What would be in or out of this? So non-garage, everything that's flat on one, is that what we're defining as on-street? Or are we talking like off the side of the road?
Vice Mayor Taylor, we are not discussing any surface lots, so it would be all of the areas that border, that are within the district that have
the
actual on-street parking. Curbs.
Like Costino's, the Hale, that's what we're defining. And how many approximately are we talking about? A couple hundred?
It's more than
on the street?
I just think we're overusing the term master plan in this instance. This should be a component of the overall parking master plan, but to say we're going to master plan the on-street parking, I think is just a little bit beyond my ability to understand.
There you go.
Making a component of the overall parking master plan is fine with me, but designating it as a separate type of... Yeah, I see this as being...
So, Mayor, for clarity on that, I agree with you. Is this something we're doing internally, or is this something we're hiring a consultant for?
Councilmember Peterson, this would be done internally.
Okay, thank you.
I think the key part is it's part of the 2018 redevelopment plan update, which we are utilizing a consultant to develop that piece of, or I guess I should even say the final report piece. I think we're doing a lot of the internal stakeholder pieces of that, but I think it's a hybrid.
Okay.
So staff would provide information within an overall parking policy and plan for uniformity and consistency of our on-street parking and provide additional information to council. As part of the redevelopment plan update.
That's a good catch. That's right.
Okay, we are unanimous there. Same thing. So this would be revising our recommendation. This would then be an overall staff would return as part of the overall component and include information on curb lane management and that particular component. And that would be included with the redevelopment plan update.
Are we live?
Any questions?
Again, if we could just specify that this is part of the 2018 redevelopment plan rather than something that you're coming back with us between now and 18 months.
Thank you, Mayor. We are unanimous there.
That's right. 48 questions. Can we get a little time check here or process?
Amanda? This is our very last component. And I think this is the one that we figured would have most discussion, so we saved the best for last. But I think this is certainly the area that we're all concerned with in this. You know, this is parking financing, so the methods to finance the development of parking, operations and maintenance, replacement of that infrastructure, and any transportation-related improvements. So we looked, based on the fact that we have a shared parking model, we looked at all of the cost recovery best practices. Again, there's really not a, even if you combined various portions of this, there's not a 100% cost recovery model that also facilitates and encourages development. So for us, it's really finding the key components that we can utilize to mitigate our financial responsibility. So I'm just going to read through the options as you guys are reading them on the slide. So paid parking, we've talked about, we've eliminated that, at least in the current time. Paid parking on street would also be eliminated based on our direction for the current, for the time being. We have an option for a developer fee by administrative use permit. So rather than a developer developing their parking on site, the space is there, unable to develop on site, they would then pay a fee for those parking spaces that would be part of their administrative use permit. This could also be a fee for businesses that we can look at as well. So the parking ratio requirements, same thing. The businesses would then pay for parking based on their parking ratio requirements not met on site. We could do parking leases by occupier. So businesses may lease specific parking spaces. That doesn't mean that they necessarily are leasing the space closest to their business, but we have seen this model work very efficiently in other cities that have office users. So rather than an office user not having any idea of where they're parking and walking for 10 minutes to get to work, trying to find parking, it centralizes them. Paid employee parking, so businesses would pay a fee or put that fee to their employee to pay for utilizing a space in the district. There's an opportunity to create a business improvement district. Landowners are then assessed annually to fund activities and improvements to promote business district, to promote that business district. And we also are looking at the potentiality of a revolving parking fund, so dedicating a portion of either sales or bed tax generated from the Heritage District. When we started asking you, you know, we asked you who should be responsible. Sorry, I'm going to see if I can move this over. Who should be responsible for the cost of developing? Check all that apply. You can see that Town of Gilbert is still shouldering a large part of that, with developers also being looked at as a responsible party. We asked, you know, about the everyday operations and maintenance, check all that apply. Again, we have Town of Gilbert, but we also have, you know, 65% also thought that the businesses should be included in that O&M cost. And then we asked who should be responsible for the cost of infrastructure repairs and construction-related upgrades to the public parking. And again, you can see that, you know, there's certainly a mix in each of these components.
There was some other on that and asked to specify. What is that?
Yes, so within the other, we had a number of responses that said looking at utilizing a sales tax was one, utilizing a bed tax, and we also had a request about a business improvement district type of an operation. We asked, do we think current Heritage District businesses and residents should be required to financially participate? 55% said yes, and 35% were not sure. We did a comparison, again, of those benchmark cities and our surrounding cities to see what they're utilizing for their financing. A number of them are using business leases, monthly payments, a couple of them fee in lieu, and the metered, so this is that convenience type parking.
So our recommendation would be to establish a dedicated Heritage District parking fund in the immediate term, so 0 to 18 months. We are working with Walker Consultants. They're a national parking consultant. We're working with them on Garage Number 2's master plan. Within their scope of work for that contract, which has already been approved by council, they are being asked to look at the policies that we would like to examine. So they're just waiting for direction from us on which of those financing options they should look at and review the impact, review the ROI, and the impact it would have to the town and new business. What we felt was the best of those options from the best practices was looking at a potential percentage of the sales tax, looking at a percentage of the bed tax, because this is certainly a tourist area, a potentiality of a business improvement district, looking at that developer business occupier fee per administrative use permit, and lease agreements by occupier. But we're certainly open to any other options that you would like them to review. The goal would then be for us to come back to council no later than May 2017 with all of this information so that we can make a determination on how to finance.
So parking fund would pay for O&M and new construction?
So the parking fund would be a revolving parking fund. These are potential these are potential areas then that could feed into that parking dedicated parking fund.
Right, I got that. But what are we going to be using the money for? Like if we designate $2 million, is that just for O&M? Is it for new parking? Is it for what is it? What are we looking to use those dollars for?
Mayor, thank you. Yes.
Restricting dollars. If it's just coming to the general fund anyway.
The concept behind the Heritage District Parking Fund would pay for the initial infrastructure, O&M, and that repairing. And that would be where that dedicated fund.
So the problem with that is it actually goes against our adopted financial policies. And we've adopted financial policies that talk about repair and replacement, which is your O&M, and that CIP capital dollars for a one-time use are kept separate from those O&M dollars. And so I think we need to clarify that internally before we make that determination. I'm looking at Kelly over there as the expert in our financial policies to really help us to delineate. Because as far as a repair and replacement, I actually think we should be setting aside dollars for that. But I think we need to clarify what this fund is to be used for, what specific uses might it have.
And Mayor, your point about restricting it versus setting aside, that's probably a discussion too. Some years we might have more than others, so restricting more than we need maybe not be the best policy.
Thank you, Mayor, Council, Kelly Fost, the Budget Director. You are correct that we do have a policy of using our most restricted funds first. We can, if you choose, restrict the general fund dollars for this purpose. We don't have a legal responsibility to. There are other items that we do on an annual basis for repair and replacement and for capital that would not be following this pattern. If we were to follow our typical pattern, then we would set aside money in our repair and replacement for infrastructure like this. But at your direction, we definitely could earmark these particular funds for this purpose if you desired.
I think the current model works great. It gives us the flexibility we need to manage the ebbs and flows of what might be, instead of restricting dollars, I think we'd want that flexibility in our general fund, but just my thought on that.
I think, though, the idea is to make it really obvious and clear what dollars have been taken specifically for that purpose, to make sure we're giving people the value that they deserve for those purposes. And so it's just a way to keep it separate. Ultimately, as a council, we have the authority over those funds, but it's just a tool. I think it makes sense to do that, to have that separate fund. But that's just my opinion.
I do think it's smart for us to start a repair and replacement fund for this asset. I mean, we have, this is an asset now. We need to make sure that we're maintaining it and have an emphasis on maintaining it.
Well, I think we just have our normal CIP, like with any streets infrastructure. But I was thinking that this would be for the, you know, the M&O that we seem to be struggling with. I could see that level of funding that we collect for that purpose. But to me, the CIP would be just our normal, what we normally do with any street or with any sidewalk, with any infrastructure that we do. This should be just included as part of the CIP. So I don't see how dedicating funds, it just should be normal, you know, long-term strategic planning that we normally do anyways.
Is this M&O and construction?
Councilmember Canlin, the idea is that we can be as flexible as we want with the parking fund. The idea is that we would have a source to designate. Initially, our idea was that, yes, we would be able to pull construction dollars from there and some of the maintenance and operations. A lot of that will be determined by the impact analysis and the ROI model that we discover from Walker Parking Consultants.
Because I would say that it's smart to take some of these things, especially the taxes that are coming from the area, and dedicate those to the building of the paying cash is never a bad thing for infrastructure like this.
So Mayor, it's probably going to depend a lot also on which kinds of things we want to go with as far as funding and what kind of funding we want it to be, whether one kind of source is just for O&M, another kind of source is for the capital side. You know, if we only want one or the other, then the fund only serves one of those purposes. Well, I would even be open, and maybe this is too complex, but if we wanted two different funds, one that's for the capital side and the other that's for the O&M, to make it clear, you know, we've got one source that feeds into one that's for that purpose, another source that feeds into the other for the other purpose. I mean, I don't know. I just think that makes a lot of sense, just to make it clear, doesn't get lost. People get what they're supposed to based on why we're collecting those fees.
Mayor, Councilmember Peterson, I would recommend that that is one of the items that we work with Walker Consultant to better understand is how to best break out a parking district fund if we were to do that, and certainly which of these financing options would be best for each area. So best for the infrastructure, the upgrades, and O&M if we decide to do that. So they would put that into a full matrix for us.
So the recommendation is that we have Walker bring this back to us by May of 2017. Okay.
Mayor, council members, that would be correct.
Is the fund part of the recommendation?
They want to explore. Walker's going to come back to us with the fund, how to fund the fund. Yeah.
Okay. But are we giving direction about creating the fund with this?
No.
Poll?
No, at this point, the recommendation will simply be to have Walker Consultants not only provide a financial impact based on these financial models, but also to look at a parking fund, what that would look like, and what areas of this would then rotate into it.
Does this increase Walker's scope? I mean, are we now? No, this is part of their current scope, and so we've already contracted with them, and we're already paying them a set amount. Okay, just making sure.
Mayor, I've got one last, and I don't know that this fits into this scope here, but I'm really, really interested to know the overall expense versus revenue of the downtown, and that includes all expenses versus all revenues, so we can really get a sense of the ROI, because I know for a lot of people on this council, and I'm included in that, depending on how these numbers look, but if there's a true positive ROI on all these investments in the parking and so on and so forth, so that we can see there truly isn't on the net, when you include everything, there isn't a subsidy, then that changes the conversation for me dramatically. But I don't have the data to really be able to understand that. And
some of that ROI, though, isn't going to be measured in sales tax dollars. How many people have moved to Gilbert in the last year and a half because They loved what they came and saw in downtown, and they were able to feel and understand Gilbert. We don't know that, and I don't know that you're going to be able to capture that to be able to turn it around to give you the data that you might need. You can do a we can do a direct cost recovery piece, but I don't think that tells the whole story.
No, Mayor, and then, you know, if you think about the parking garage, that may be a 50-year lifespan. So your ROI, you know, you're going to have to do 50 years. I mean, so I appreciate what you're saying, but we're going to have to set the boundaries of what is an acceptable lifespan of a structure that's going to last 50 years. Do I do my ROI in 50 years?
Another aspect of that is how many people are now reinvesting in the residential component of downtown. Are we really capturing those construction sales tax dollars as part of that ROI? Probably not. As we do the analysis, you're really only capturing the sales tax dollars within
I want it to be comprehensive. I don't want to exclude. I'm not saying just sales tax. I'm saying anything related to the economic activity of the downtown, I'm fine with including. I just, I'm sure that this council isn't interested in investing $2 only to get a dollar back in any part of our town. I think we're all interested in that positive return for our citizens.
What's your time frame to get your $2 back? I mean, that's what Eddie's saying. Eddie's saying, essentially, is this a long-term investment or is this a short-term investment?
You can annualize those things. So you'd have to figure out the total life of each piece. And I've done some of this work. It can be done, but you'd have to annualize it, do some averages. There's some assumptions, things you have to do. But I don't think it's out of the scope of possibility. And Patrick and I have talked about this before, and I've never seen anything about this, and I'm hoping that I can learn more about that going forward.
Mayor, Councilmember Peterson, if you'll recall, part of the 8 areas of focus for us this year leading into a redevelopment plan is certainly a comprehensive understanding of our operations and maintenance costs. I believe that we had that when we look at the schedule we put together coming before you, either March or April, so that could certainly coincide with the Walker study. And I was looking at our analyst as you were requesting some of that information regarding the return on investment, and it seems possible that we could provide a good bit of that as we do the O&M as well.
I just think if that's the only thing you're basing your decisions on, whether it is a dollar for dollar ROI based on a finite number of years, no one's ever going to be satisfied with that. The decision that you make based on that, I don't think will ever capture the total ROI, because some of these things are not going to be able to be calculated.
Well, I don't think it's an unreasonable question to ask, and I think you make a valid point about, let's look at the big picture, how does it fit in? But remember, every time we get a development agreement, it's always a dollar return. So I think a little accountability for the taxpayers is a reasonable thing for us to ask for. No question there's intangibles and there's other stuff that you can't really measure, but and there's a difference between NPV and IRR, right? So you can do calculations that look at a whole project or your rate of return on an annual basis. That's just basic business math. But to have some accountability to our taxpayers, because over the years we've had a lot of investments that have been promised the taxpayers specific dollar returns. And so for someone to say, let's just look and do an accounting, maybe a snapshot type of accounting with the qualifiers that there's lots of other things, I don't think that's totally unreasonable to ask.
You know, we do it all the time with development agreements. And furthermore, if we don't care, we don't think that's a worthwhile endeavor, and on average, we keep investing $2 and get a dollar back, we're going to be in the hole and we're going to have major trouble. So I think we should. I'm not saying it's a sole decision-making thing, but if you don't have that yardstick to kind of help keep you on track, you're going to get off track. And I think it's a valuable tool, and it's certainly one that should be, able to be assembled, in my opinion.
Mayor, members of the council, I think we can definitely put something together for you that would show the direct economic impact coming back to the town through those fees and taxes, as well as the indirect impacts to the community. Something else to keep in mind is not only the revenues that will derive from the district from all of the new business creation we have down there and the subsequent increase in property values, but the impact that will have on the surrounding areas. That's one of the oldest portions of our community. That's where we see the lowest socioeconomic conditions within Gilbert. And as those property values raise, that will emanate out and have a positive net impact that will go beyond the borders of the district as people seek to create additional business opportunities there, as well as living opportunities. But we can give you something that will give you a good frame of reference for the investment we'll make there and the return the community will see on that.
I don't have a problem with the report being done. I just want to make that clear. I do have a problem if we are going to use that then as the Bible truth to whether we should or should not continue to reinvest in our downtown. My reason being is if you're only looking at a few factors, and you said there has to be certain assumptions made when you're developing this type of ROI type report, it is very difficult to establish that. If you're using it as one tool, that's fine. But from what I see is once we have data in front of us, it becomes the driver, if you will, in some of this decision making. And if a council 30 years ago had decided that unless they had a certain ROI on the land purchases that they were making within a very specific time frame, they would have stopped investing in downtown. And I don't think that would have benefited the community as a whole, especially now that we have hindsight, right? Hindsight's always 20/20. So I just urge us to use this information with caution as we move forward, because yes, it can be a valuable tool, but it can also be a hindrance to long-term vision and commitment to some of our redevelopment areas. And when I say redevelopment, this would be something that could be mirrored for our Fiesta Tech District and some of the aging areas of our commercial businesses that if we do not maintain and if we do not continue to invest in 30 years from now, councils will be cursing us because of once they turn, it is very difficult to get back. So I just stood on my soapbox for just a second to make that statement. But I really do feel strongly about, fine if we're going to use it as a tool, but let's not make this the driver in some of these decisions.
Mayor, I'm just hearkening back to the conversation we had at a retreat where you supported the idea of looking at the total return on investment, all things considered, meaning what we made on the resale of land and things like that. And the notion was, hey, whatever we make as a surplus on all that can be reinvested into things like parking. And again, as from a high level, I think that's a reasonable notion. And that's what I'm trying to do, is kind of establish some of those, you know, those concepts and see how that's working and if we're heading in the right direction. At the end of the day, more data is more information that's helpful. You can do with it as you will, but I think it's more dangerous to be afraid of what the data says and not want to look at it because we're afraid of those results. I think it's more important to look at the realities, look at the facts, be very, very cautious about what your assumptions are, you know, be open about what you do and don't know, and take it with a grain of salt, of course.
Yeah, no one's afraid.
Anyway, that's my thought.
I think we might be ready to vote on parking financing.
So the recommendation would be that we would return to council with the financial impact to the town and looking at the options for a potential parking fund and how that would operate.
Station. Where are we pointing to?
Where's the thing? I broke it. No, there we go. Okay, unanimous. So I know that this has been a tremendous amount of information within those six areas, and Vince has a slide if you'd like me to quickly recap.
Go to
what the direction has been. I can pull that up really quickly. Would that be beneficial? Okay.
You did good.
Let the record. That's right. So what are we doing?
Yeah.
I do have another question, Mayor. Are we going to? So. I'm not sure how to say this. I know one of the things I struggled with on the parking garage was the lack of a policy. This is outstanding. This is really well thought out. It makes the C in me very proud because I just love the analytical approach here. At the same time, it's probably going to take a couple of years for us to really haul all this in and establish a process that's meaningful. Do we have what we need for like the immediate future to make some good decisions? I was hoping that that's what would come out of this. And now that I walked through this, I know that's not totally practical, but I guess that's just a thought, Mayor. Maybe we don't have the answer on that right now, but we're going to have some parking related decisions to make. I want to make sure that we have good information to move forward.
I think two of the big ones that we made the determination on tonight was, number one, retaining the shared parking model that we have, and we basically did that in perpetuity as a council. And I think that was the direction that we've given, and that will be a key factor in the policy that comes forward for us to adopt. I also think, though, that having no paid parking for at least the next 3 years is the policy that direction that we've given. And I think those two things, I mean, obviously each piece of this was a component and had importance, but those are two of the key things that I think we did today that will be imperative in the parking policy. Are you thinking of something else that we didn't talk about?
Well, we've talked, you know, Councilmember Ray talked a little bit about a south parking garage potentially. We also have a couple of other potential development agreements that might bind parking commitments. So I guess I'm not seeing any major conflicts here, but I guess Patrick, maybe you and Dan, is there anything that we need to clarify here yet tonight of things you're working on here that are loose ends or additional guidance for certain agreements
Sure.
you're talking with now?
Mayor, Vice Mayor Taylor, I think that I concur with Mayor Daniels' summation of the two key things to come out of tonight, and part of this is a process, and it's a journey of decisions we will make in regards to how the Heritage District continues to develop, and things such as commuter rail, things such as future circulation and changing streets and corridors to allow for densification of the district and additional uses to come in. So as we make those decisions and tackle those issues, we'll bring all the necessary data forward at that time to make those key decisions. But I think for tonight, we've got good direction. And as we continue to amend or update the redevelopment plan and make some decisions in all these key areas, it will continue to define itself.
I think you bring up a good point, though. Parking licenses, which we have voted on for the common bond agreement. Is that something that we want to continue to explore with our different users in downtown, or was that specific because of a request made in an RFP? I actually think that would be a key piece of this overall, because if we're not going to explore them anymore unless we're asking for something unique, is there an opportunity for someone to explore that, for instance, for the business component, which Amanda mentioned earlier?
Right. Mayor, council members, I think that's something unique depending on the use that comes in. When we had a request at one time to bring in some residential and they needed dedicated parking as a part of that, you certainly do. I think the latest development agreement to come through for Common Bond and the yard concept, it was driven by the need for the banquet space, and we understood that. But I think staff's mindset is that we agree the less restrictions and the more free use of parking that we can maintain in the district, the better it will be to meet the demands of the parking under a shared parking model within the district. So I think we just want to evaluate that each time on a case-by-case basis.
So then the policy the written policy then that will be incorporated into this is we will look at administrative licenses, parking licenses, on a case-by-case basis.
Yes, I would agree with that.
Which doesn't really provide the policy piece that I think Jordan was asking for. Right. I think it instead, I think when we have commercial, when we have a business use, if we had, right, let's say a large scale, St. Xavier size building that ended up being employment, let's just right, say, and they wanted to use part on site, part off, part shared, I think we would have to do a license in order to make that happen.
Right. I think that our policy is that the town will endeavor to maintain an open shared parking environment in which there are no restrictive uses placed on parking except for special circumstances that require it based on use or activity.
Okay. That, I think that clarifies it, but I think that language would need to be included in the overall parking policy that was brought forward.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes. Okay. And then you had one other, which is future parking garages, but I think that that's probably going to be incorporated into the overall redevelopment plan / master plan.
Agreed, and driven by specific land uses.
Mayor, council members, thank you. So we realize that some of the verbiage of these items will change, and I have this all written down. So, but essentially, we're looking at the immediate term of retaining our shared model. We'll return with the Walker recommendations for financing and looking at the parking funding. We will return with the wayfinding information on what that would look like to do wayfinding light, purchasing a dynamic parking tool, looking at can we utilize internal GIS for a tool of that nature, and the ROI that it would provide to the town to have that type of a tool. Immediate also implement the pilot program for employee parking. We will come back with information regarding Kim Lee Horn's recommendations. As we look at the 3 years or less, that would be that employee parking component based on the pilot, bringing that information back to you, reevaluating the pros and cons of the on-street parking as part of the redevelopment plan, so that holistic parking policy, revisiting all of those financing options again. I included that particularly because the policies will continue to evolve as the district evolves, so we just need to be really cognizant of those time frames. Revisit paid parking 3 to 5 years, so we'll move that up. Looking at curb lane management as part of the redevelopment plan, bring back in the immediate term more information on reducing our parking ratio and the potential need for that, and also a residential parking program in the immediate term.
Well done.
The only thing I see is it says 12 to 18 months in your near term, and I think your first slide said 0 to 18 months.
It's zero. Yes.
Okay. So just
sorry about that.
And then the there was one that you said that was going to be, I think it was the next slide. Sorry. The pros and cons of on-street parking, that would really actually be 12 to 18 months to take us to 2018 rather than 1 to 3. I guess it could potentially fall in either, but if we stick to a 2018 time frame, or if it was, I'm assuming it's a fiscal year 18, not
correct.
Just,
okay. Mayor,
so then
correct.
That would be 18 months.
So we've made a lot of decisions and are given a lot of direction, and we're gonna be busy on parking policy, which is a good thing. I think it's really going to benefit the district, and we really appreciate your direction tonight. It's very, very helpful in helping us just continue to move this along.
I think this was extremely well organized for so many complicated conversations. I just want to compliment you on that, really. It was great. Thank you.
Let's do a round of applause for Amanda and her team. And we're sorry you had to work through Thanksgiving weekend. Sorry. No. I love what I do, so it doesn't really feel like work, quite frankly. Thank you, Amanda.
So, Mayor and Council, we thank you for your time and your efforts and direction on this. I'd be remiss in addition to thanking Amanda, but certainly the work and the support of Kathy and the chamber, the work of the merchants, certainly the various departments ranging from engineering, public works, certainly the manager's office, obviously development services and planning. We couldn't do it without the work of Linda and Kyle, certainly, and all the work that the planners do in the Heritage District to make the projects viable and successful, in addition to a number of consultants, but also certainly Jacob, Patrick, Mark, Skosipic, I think I said that correctly, and just the work to bring all of this together in an organized and concise fashion. Really thank you for your time and efforts, so thank you.
Meeting adjourned. Do I have to say that? It's called Go Home and Eat.
Thank you.